You're listening to The Breakfast Boys here on Triple H 100.1 in our Small Biz Matters Hour of Power. Alexi, how are you this morning?
Good morning, boys. Nice to have me on the show.
Not too sick, are you?
No, there's something coming. Everyone's been falling, just dropping like flies, and there is, it's coming for me. It's like having the black dog chase me.
That we're all in a room.
Yeah,
with you,
I'm trying to hold my breath, but you know, I'm not very good at that.
So, we have a guest today.
We did. Very excited about welcoming to the show a professional who's extremely experienced. I've been looking forward to having Cheryl on the show for quite a couple of months now. Business coach and director of Be Ultimate. She's kindly joined us to help small businesses with selecting the right business coach, which is something that she, being very experienced as a business coach herself, is of course an expert, but more importantly understands that there are lots of different types. And my dealings with small to medium sized businesses, everyone out there would like to maybe engage with a business coach, but they don't really know where to start. They don't really know what to look for, what questions to ask, and I guess the different types of coaches, and that's what we're going to be looking at today. Obviously keeping it, as we always do on Small Biz Matters, very strategic, very simple, very specific, so that you walk away feeling a little bit more empowered in your business. So first, let's be clear about how we're approaching it. We're going to first break it into three parts. Why businesses should consider engaging with a business coach. What are the top seven mistakes businesses make, which is if you're ticking all seven boxes, might want to think about engaging with a business coach to help you get out of that hole. And lastly, the different types of business coaches and how to choose the right one. So it's going to be a very jam-packed show
riveting
today.
Yes.
Cheryl, while I'm, you know, on the topic, what exactly, this is a very basic, like, hello,
Jake.
I'm 6 years old. Yeah, thank you, Alexi. But what exactly does a business coach do? What is their role or task, as you should say?
Okay, well, first of all, can I say hello to everybody?
Hello. Welcome on the show.
Thanks for having me on board. Okay, so basically, a lot of people ask me more specifically, what's the difference between a business consultant and a business coach? So a business consultant is someone who works for a consulting firm, and you pay them to come into your business, assess what's not working, and actually implement for you things to improve the business. A business coach is more of a mentoring role. What we do is we help people look at their business from the outside. We bring in knowledge that they don't already have, to help them with what they're trying to achieve in their business. And then we enable them so that they can take the actions in their business. We don't do it for them. It's very much about empowering the individual and helping them get educated and skilled in the areas they need to, so they can then go and run the business for them. A bit like teaching someone a fish rather than handing them fish and chips.
Yeah, that's very interesting, actually, because I've never really thought of a defined explanation between the difference of a consultant and a coach, and that really clears it up, because I guess with what I do, going into businesses and getting those things implemented and all those different admin things that we've talked about on the show, that makes me a consultant.
Absolutely.
Excellent. I've just defined myself.
Now you know what you do, Alexa.
Yes, thank you.
That's a good start.
It is indeed. And so talking about why it is beneficial to look at the overall scheme, why would you engage with a business coach? At what stage of experiencing problems or not experiencing problems should you think about engaging with a coach, for instance?
That's a really good answer. There actually is no answer to that, because we basically can go anything from a startup who hasn't even launched their business yet and wants to get everything right from the beginning, lay their foundations and move into their business ready and equipped, to someone who's been in business for 5 years, just really hit a ceiling in their growth, used all the tools they already have, used up all the knowledge they already have, and are just kind of stuck in this holding pattern where they can't grow, they can't make any more money, they don't seem to be bringing in any more clients, but they really don't know what else they can do.
Yeah, yeah, and that is an important aspect of it, isn't it? The growth and hitting that feeling as though they're maxed out and they're thinking, well, I'm working like a dog, I can't seem to get any bigger, I can't seem to improve on my bottom line, what is it that I'm doing wrong? And you're probably looking at things like, what is it that they're working too hard at, or are they just being really clunky about, and that sort of thing? And what about the actual growth of a business? So when you're looking at, say, taking on new staff, or if they want to take their business to a new level, is that somewhere another instance where people might engage with a business coach as well?
Absolutely, absolutely. We are in the business of long-term, sustainable, profitable businesses. A lot of businesses, when they start off, they have that really high, what we call happy zone, where they're new, they're exciting, people are noticing them, the clients are coming in, everything's really exciting. But then what happens about a year or two down the line is that that levels off and suddenly
plateau,
sales are dropping instead of growing, and then they're doing exactly what they've always done and it worked before, and they really don't know what's happened. And yeah, they need help just kind of breathing some more life. And they're also very much in their business. So most business owners, when they come to me, they're doing, if not everything, and I'm sure you have this too, Alexi, almost everything in their business. They're working really long hours most of the time, if it's their own business. A lot of them are absolutely exhausted. And adrenal fatigue is something that comes up a lot, funnily enough.
We were just talking about that this morning.
There you go. And they are so busy just trying to keep going and do everything and keep up to date with everything. They actually don't step outside and look at the business from a strategic angle.
It's almost impossible to do that after a couple of years anyway. You're so embedded in what you do that you can't take that step back and look in. And it's that sort of real emotional attitude towards their business. They find it difficult getting back on track or revisiting those things they originally started out doing. I mean, they might have had a business plan. They might have had someone who helped them with their startup. But it's been 2 years down the track. They've got into this rut. This is how they work. Mm. They haven't revisited those original plans or processes that they said they were going to put in place but just haven't got around to doing because they've been so busy.
Mm. And I'm going to pull you up on that because 90% of small businesses don't have a business plan.
This is true. This is true. Or even any sort of processes and procedures.
Or fixed goals that they're trying to achieve even. And if you don't have goals and you don't know what you're aiming for, you're really just kind of drifting around. So that's something we work on quite a bit as well, is actually creating really fixed, tangible goals and business planning. And anyone who has done a full business plan should be reviewing it 12 monthly and 2 yearly anyway, because businesses grow, they change direction.
And the markets business, change as well.
Absolutely. Yeah, and the business market that you thought you were creating 2 years ago can be completely different to the business that you're creating today.
Mm, mm. No, it's interesting because in that way, that's one way, perhaps if you're thinking, or you should be thinking, about, you go, right, I'm going to pull my finger out, I'm actually going to do my business plan. That would be a good point to actually engage with a business coach and they can assist you with that planning process.
Absolutely. And it doesn't have to be a 50-page corporate document.
Yeah.
And I think that's what a lot of people think when they hear the words business plan. They think of that corporate model, you know, the folder and the binding and the page after page of graphs and numbers and all those horrible things that small business owners don't like.
Mm.
It doesn't have to be that. It can be an A4 page with dot points. You know, it's whatever version of planning works for you, but it's just actually having some strategy behind what you're doing instead of just being on survival mode.
Right. And I think as well, I guess it almost becomes, you're so embedded in your business and you're so emotionally attached to it, it almost becomes impossible to be professional.
It's absolutely
almost too difficult to have that professional outlook and to take a step back and go, actually, no, I'm stuffing that up quite badly and I need to do something different about it. It's hard to say that to yourself, I think. And your friends aren't going to tell you.
No, and their business is their baby.
Mm.
So it'd be like someone saying to you, there's something wrong with your child, please go fix them.
Yes, no. Or your people parenting.
Don't want to hear that, exactly. They're very emotional. Small business owners are passionate about what they're doing. You know, people don't put in that amount of effort and that amount of time and that amount of heartache.
Exactly.
Unless they really feel for what they're trying to achieve.
Is it a management point of view? Because when I think of a lot of small business owners, they might have come from a position where they've got the experience, the tangible experience to create what they're doing, or they might have been an apprentice coming into a tradesman position. But very few of them have got that management, those management skills. So therefore, they can't apply those management skills to their own business. Difficult as enough as it is because it's your business. Is that another advantage to having a business coach, is those, they should have that experience at a management level?
Absolutely. And people only know what they know. They often don't know what they don't know.
Mm.
And we run quite a few in-house workshops, as you know. I think you've possibly attended one.
Yeah, that'd be ultimate. They're fantastic, actually.
And what we often find is people are sitting in that room going, oh, I didn't even know you could do that.
Yes.
I didn't even know that existed. You know, especially in particular, because our workshops are often about social media, especially regarding social media. But small business owners, if they haven't had experience running a business before, which most people haven't, then there's so many things they don't even know exist.
Mm-hmm.
So many things that they don't even have any knowledge of. So they don't even know they don't know it. So they can't go learn it because they don't know it.
And the professionals that they can outsource to, they wouldn't even know who to approach if they needed help with blah.
Yeah.
They don't know where to go.
And they have that perception that everything costs lots of money.
Mm, that's right.
And that's a knowledge thing as well.
Something that I always come back to with this program, and we always mention it at every show, is that it's very important to understand what your time is worth. In terms, and not just in terms of valuing your own time on a psychological level, but also in terms of putting a dollar figure on it. Mm. What exactly do you charge out your time at? Now, if you can get a consultant or someone to assist you and outsource something to, and they cost less than you do, then it's pretty obvious you shouldn't be spending that time doing something that someone will cost less to do for you. You should be working in or on or other aspects of your business which you can do. So it's very much about valuing your time. And like you said, a lot of those outsourced things don't necessarily cost the earth.
Yeah, and there's a word we use a lot called investment.
So
there's a difference between having expenses for your business and investing in the future of your business.
Mm, exactly. Yes, well, that just sort of covers why it would be that a small business would want to engage with a business coach and at what stage they would want to do it. So when we come back after the break,
of course,
we're going to look at those 7 top mistakes small businesses make. Very scary.
Stay tuned, Breakfast Boys. Will be back with Small Biz Matters in our Small Biz Matters Hour of Power with Alexi Boyd from Boyd Office Management, Sherald Alderman, Business Coach, Director of B Ultimate. Ladies, welcome back.
Thank you for having us.
And what are we talking about now?
Yeah, so we're going to be discussing top 7 mistakes small businesses make. Now, I was lucky enough to go to an event the other night at the lovely Green Gate Hotel with Cheryl, where she spoke about the errors. It really is a mistake that businesses make, and we all make them. And it was whether or not we could sit there and say, okay, do we all do all 7 or do we do 1 or 2? And I don't think there'd be very many businesses out there that are inescapable for at least 1 or 2, I would say. I hope not, because I felt bad about having 2 the other night, so I don't want to have more than that, have less than that. So superhero syndrome. Explain that one to me.
Okay, we kind of touched on that a bit earlier. Most small businesses are doing everything in their business. They're doing the accounting, they're doing the administration, they're doing the sales, they're doing the business development, they're doing the face-to-face and everything else in between. They don't have staff. They are very, very much living on that hamster wheel where they're just running and running and running and running and trying to keep everything going.
Mm. And terrible at outsourcing. That's the problem.
And they have this lovely syndrome called compulsive yes syndrome, which means that every time anyone suggests anything else, they go, oh, yes, that's a great idea. And they chuck something else onto their task list and get even more overwhelmed and stressed.
It was interesting because I was speaking to a good friend of mine, and I was just having coffee and something popped in my head. I just pop it on my list and she goes, your list is at the bottom of the page. And I said, yeah. And she says, how long is it going to take you to get through all those things? I went, oh, a couple of months. She said, well, don't write such a long list. Surely every time you look at that list, you become quite stressed out. So piling new stuff on top of yourself as a business owner is really quite stressful.
Mm. And often they're not very good, or they just don't even think to look at what they have to do and prioritise it.
Mm.
Everything's urgent.
Everything's
on
that list.
When you're on that hamster wheel, everything's urgent. Everything has to be done, and it's just flying around and flying around in their heads. When actually, if you sit down with them and go through things slowly and objectively, probably 50% of those things on the list can either be outsourced or deferred or just completely taken off.
Yeah, I think that's one of the things with my clients when I meet with them and just have even just a look at their admin processes, and they can't see the wood from the trees anymore. They're so used to doing everything with the same amount of intensity and giving everything the same priority that suddenly things, you know, that are really important just get left by the wayside and go further down the list.
Mm, that's right. And that's another place where not having strategies and goals can add to that too, because if you know exactly where you're heading, you know what's relevant and what's not, it makes it so much easier to make decisions for your business, because you know if it relates to your purpose and your direction that you'll put it in there.
So
and
just
if it doesn't, you can then, okay, I'm not even going to consider that because it's not actually relevant to where I'm heading.
Yeah, and giving that a little bit of, for an example, if you sort of say, right, in the next 4 weeks I'm going to have a bit of a social media strategy, well then things that you do are going to start being part of that strategy. Say, well, well, I said to myself that in 4 weeks I was going to do that. So maybe instead of one way of advertising, I'm going to start putting that up on my Facebook page or my LinkedIn page, or getting the information out there and trying to build my followers, for example. So if that was one of your strategies, that's what you're actually working towards.
Absolutely. And if you're working social media, you should have a very clear plan. And I can just say it should be more than 4 weeks.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Social media is a long-term marketing strategy,
it is,
not
a
short-term
lot
one.
Of time as well.
No, it actually doesn't have to be. And that's a perfect example of what small business owners think.
That it's, you know, a lot of time invested.
Yeah, it absolutely doesn't. If you know how to do it properly and you know how to do it well, then it actually takes very little time. I'm active on 4 different social media platforms a lot, and it takes me less than half an hour a day to manage the whole
lot. Sounds like I need to do your social media advanced course.
Perhaps you do.
Number 2 is undercharging.
Yes. Well, not even just undercharging. A lot of small business owners don't charge at all a lot of the time for their time, especially in the service industries. So people that are working in a service mode, like graphic designers, bookkeepers, things like that, often they get caught up and things take longer than they expect or whatever, and then they have this whole pattern of their own worth, and I can't charge that much.
And I said it was going to cost this, but it took me twice as long, so therefore I can't charge.
So they just wear it.
Yeah.
You know, and unfortunately, when you do that consistently, and it is a trend I see a lot, all you're doing is educating your clients that your time's not valuable. And it often extends to boundaries around when you can be contacted and so on.
Mm.
So, for example, my clients all know straight away up front, I tell them that I don't work weekends. My phone goes off on Friday night, it goes back on Monday morning. And I will be totally accessible as much as I can in that time. Obviously, if I'm in session, I have to take messages, but I don't work weekends. And so they know that up front. They don't expect me to work weekends. It's very rare that I get an email or anything over the weekend because I've set that expectation up front.
Mm.
So it's also about valuing your time and making those boundaries clear as well to the clients.
I think a lot of people are happy to say they've all got the idea that you give an estimate instead of a quote, so that you allow yourself that flexibility to maybe charge a little bit more if it does take a little bit more time. But then they haven't got the balls to actually, you know, charge that extra time when it did take a little bit of extra. Oh, I said it was going to cost this much and it's a brand new client. And again, you've laid the table for undervaluing yourself and your time from now on with that
client. Absolutely. And that rolls into collections as well. I have a lot of people come to me who've got major issues around collecting money from clients. And there's some really easy strategies they can implement around that, which will reduce that as an issue in their businesses.
Mm.
I had one client come to me and I actually sent a consultant who I use sometimes out to him for the day just to do collections for one day. $12,000 came in one day.
Wow.
But that's an example. He just left that sitting there. He didn't want to make the phone call. He felt like he was hassling his clients or whatever. And $12,000 outstanding, that's not a way to run a business.
No. No, that's a lot of cash flow, not in your business, but out of your business.
Mm. So they're having that kind of awkwardness around the money conversations can flow into other areas as well.
And if you're upfront about that right from the beginning, you say, right, this is going to take me 2 hours and the initial cost is going to be this, and then we move from there and see what other things. If you have that conversation right from the beginning, it gives you the confidence to then start charging your time appropriately, and it gives them the confidence to know that you're not undervaluing yourself and you're actually someone who's a professional. It's
absolutely
very important.
And then you attract the right clients, which we'll get to later.
Yes. Inappropriate advice. What do you mean by that? Who are you taking it from?
I don't mean like that, take your top off and stand there and sell coffee. That's not what I'm talking about. by inappropriate advice, I mean, I have so many people that sit there and I say, so what was your thinking behind that particular strategy? Why did you think that would work? Oh, well, my husband told me, or I was talking to the guy next door and he used to have a business and he did this. And people will ask anybody advice about their business, and they will take on board advice from people who've never owned a business, never run a business, don't know anything about owning a business or running a business. Because they know them and they've got a relationship with that person, they'll often just take that on board. And
people love giving advice, don't they?
They do.
Don't they? And everyone's an expert.
But I say to them, you know, you wouldn't go to the baker to ask him which tiles to use in your bathroom.
Right.
you know. You wouldn't go to an electrician to find out about your drainage in your backyard, you know. You go to the people who have the expertise in the area you need help in.
That's right.
So if you've got issues around contracts and things, and you say you wanted to get a subcontractor in your business, you go and talk to someone with legal experience about getting those contracts drawn up. Don't try and do it yourself.
No, if especially in the legal realm. Oh, that's really scary.
If you're not sure about your tax information, go talk to an accountant.
Mm.
You know, there's a lot of people out there with a lot of knowledge, but there's also a lot of that kind of, oh, but I don't want people to think I'm silly or dumb or uneducated.
And it's interesting because when I started back in the beginning of the year, I think I was like that. I was happy to take advice from anyone. And that's okay, I think, in a way, when you're first starting out and you're not quite sure what your business model is going to be and you're still trying to sort of flesh it out a little bit because they can look from the outside in. But you don't accept and then implement every single piece of advice from all those people. You know, take away little chunks of things, useful things that people have said to you along the way. You don't have to take everything on board and write it all down and say, right, this is part of my to-do list.
That's right.
There are people who come into your life in a business capacity who can be useful, and others who just go blah, 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 blah.
Mm. And you've also got to be very careful with the advice that you're still creating your business. Because what happens sometimes when people are taking specific advice, they suddenly realise that they've created this whole business and it's not what they wanted, it's what that person wanted. And they don't actually like this business because it's not what they had in mind. They've ended up doing what everyone else said and it's not their business.
That's right. And that's why you have to take a time to get these things set up. And even, you know, setting everything up in terms of marketing collateral and your business presence and your website, that all takes time. But what takes time as well is actually moulding where you want this to go and how you want this to be formed. It's not always as straightforward. I mean, taking on a Thermomix business or that's all set in stone. They tell you how to do everything. That's all much, much easier. It costs a lot of money as well. So starting up from scratch yourself doesn't cost anything, but you will have to, again, invest time in that.
Mm. And also, I think it's very easy for people to get ripped off when they don't have the knowledge around what experts should be charging as well. And
yes,
that's another really good place that a coach can be helpful, because we know what the going rates are for different professions. We know the type of figures you should be paying your bookkeeper, your accountant, your administrator. So we can also assist with preventing small businesses from paying ridiculous amounts of money for little return.
Mm. Like the website.
Oh, websites and marketing are a killer.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
They don't have to cost you, you know, your years.
Yeah. Your first
salary
years,
or first 2 years holidays profit. Or whatever it might be.
Now, confusing business with personal.
Yes, that's a fun one. Because small business owners, their business is their business a lot of the time, they kind of get confused about them being their business and their business being them. And they kind of have a difficulty drawing a line and realising that when they're operating in that business mode, they need to be presenting in business mode. So their profile, their professional profile, needs to be what they want their business to be perceived as, not necessarily how they are as an individual. So I'll give you an example of a situation I was placed in inadvertently. I had a client who needed a web platform, and I actually took that client to a web designer who I knew his work. He did very good work. He was very cost effective. Arranged to take her to meet him. He was a work from home business, which is fine. A lot of small businesses are. Turned up with my client, professional client, in my professional, you know, clothing. Knocked at the door. He came to the door in jeans, an untucked t-shirt and socks.
Oh.
Now, you can imagine how my face looked.
Yeah.
But imagine the perception that my client immediately got. Here am I taking her to someone that, as a professional, I've recommended her to for their business services. And here's this guy standing there in socks.
In socks.
You know. Really not smart. You need to present how you want to be perceived. So if I was her, and I didn't ask her because I really wanted to scoot past that as quickly as possible and get to what he could do, her profession of him would have immediately been sloppy, you know, lack of commitment or you know, attitude issues definitely. And, you know, how much does this guy want my business?
I would also be a bit nervous about walking into his house just thinking it's going to be a complete pigsty and maybe a little bit smelly if he doesn't wear shoes.
But it was just that you know, he's at home, he works at home, so he was in that home mode.
Mm.
But if you're receiving a client, whether you're working at home or not, you need to present professionally.
Mm.
And that goes to online as well. I think people have relentlessly heard me lecture them on their online profiles and their online photographs.
Yes. Once you start acknowledging that you are your business, then the way you present yourself on lots of different platforms is now your business, I'm
afraid.
Yeah.
And that doesn't mean you can't be in the supermarket in your daggy trackies on a Saturday morning.
Yeah, exactly.
But, you know, if you're actually in business mode, you need to look the part.
Yeah.
And you need to be consistent online so that what you look like online is also what you look like when they meet you.
Awesome, ladies. That's what our 7 ways.
No, they won't. That was only country count. That was 4. We're going to come back and do the other 3.
We'll teach him how to count. When we come back, though, invisibility. Ooh, that's kind of scary, isn't it? Invisibility, drifting without direction. Every client is my client. There's like fear and love there. Sorry, Alexi's looking at me like, what?
You're a nutcase.
Oh, just a little bit, Calum.
Yes.
Thank you.
Hey, thanks, Jay. This is the Breakfast Boys with Small Biz Matters. Jet, are you going to be my girl? We'll be back after this.
Oh, Jet, are you going to be my girl? I wonder what happened to them, but no matter. Biz matters at the moment. Small biz, in fact. You're here with Alexi and the Breakfast Boys, and we have a very special guest here today for you as well, Alexi.
Me?
I know you. No, that's hang
me.
On.
I'm not special.
I want to say you're special guest. You're always a special guest here in the hearts of the Breakfast Aww. Boys. But we also have Cheryl Alderman, who is a business coach and director of Be Ultimate. Once again, for the third time, welcome.
Thank you.
This morning, we were all talking about business plans and everything, but our part two of it, we were talking about the 7 mistakes small businesses make. And we went over 4 of them before the break, and we're up to invisibility, which is number 5. It sounds so mysterious.
Mysterious. Well, it is a bit. It's I guess it's about not being seen.
Mm.
I guess it comes under the marketing realm, but it would also be maybe having sort of a bit of a marketing strategy, not seeing it through, or not having any advertising collateral whatsoever, or even presenting yourself or hiding in the corner of a room. All those sort of things come under that banner.
Yeah, absolutely. And there are many, many, many absolutely fantastic businesses out there that nobody's aware of.
Mm.
That pretty much comes under, do you have a marketing plan? What's your strategy? Is it an effective one? What have you done in the past? What could you do that you're not aware you can do? And we're basically just really nutting down with them. How can we make sure people know that your business exists?
Does it also cover the elevator pitch? You know, when you've got that opportunity, that 15 seconds to talk about what you do, does that also making sure you've got that up your sleeve so you've got it ready to go when somebody says, so what do you do?
Yeah, although I'm not a big fan of the elevator pitch myself.
Think it's too short?
No, I just think when you're talking to someone else on a business sense, you know, you should be asking them about what are the issues they're having, what do they need help with, what's going on in their business, and that will give you your elevator pitch as such. Mm. That will tell you what to talk to about them.
Yeah.
So, you know, I don't stand there and go, hi, I'm Cheryl, I'm a business coach, and I do this, this, and this. That's really, to me, not authentic.
Mm.
So if you're working with me, we probably wouldn't be looking at that. We'd be looking more at the overall strategy, the overall planning. And as with everything else in your business, you should have milestones that you plan ahead and you know exactly what you're aiming for in your visibility for your business and how you're achieving that and different strategies in play.
Great. Excellent. Drifting without direction.
Yes, we kind of touched on that a few times already this morning. Like I said, most businesses don't have a business plan. Most businesses don't have set goals, particularly financial, and often they actually don't even know where their finances are at. It's amazing how many people
cash
don't
flow.
Know their sales, they don't know their expenses, they don't know if they're actually making a profit or not. They're so, especially if it's just them, they've often got capital flowing in and out from their personal accounts, and they actually aren't even accountable for that. They don't actually know what the financial situation of their business is. So getting really clear about the vision, the direction, the goals of the business, and then, like I say, breaking that down into milestones and strategies that they can actually put in place over a long period of time.
Something I really appreciated doing, somebody gave me the advice when I started, of having a set of goals but have a 6-month plan or 6-month set of goals, a 12-month set of goals and a 24-month. So the ones that I knew were going to obviously take more effort and take longer to achieve, I pushed them back a little bit, but I still gave them a deadline.
Mm.
So I think that made them attainable, but I didn't sound as if I was just putting them towards the back of the you know, back of the pile and ignoring them altogether.
Absolutely. And there's lots of different strategies around how to do your goal setting and your planning.
Mm.
It's not really a 2-minute radio conversation.
No, and I was thinking, yeah, even cash flow is not a 2-minute radio conversation.
No, no, no. There's so many minutes. So much.
But finally, on your number seven is pretty much mi casa is su casa. Every client is my client. That sort of comes down to, you know, my reputation is coming from them, isn't it?
No.
Oh. It means.
Well, every client is my client is probably the biggest disease that small businesses catch. Every single person that comes to me, I have to get them to be my client. Everyone who wants a service, I'll find a way to offer that service. Everyone who wants a version of what I do, I'm going to make my product or my service stretch to fit their requirements. Every client doesn't have to be your client. You want a long-term, sustainable, profitable business. You don't want the bad clients. You don't want the bad payers. You don't want the high-maintenance clients that cause you headaches, drag the job out, and are just a nightmare to work with. If you work in your own business, you want to get up every day and go, yes, you know, what's going to happen today? Who am I going to be working with today? So there's lots and lots of different strategies we put in play to actually weed out the clients that you don't want, to teach business owners that they have permission to sack clients.
Yeah, that's, you know, a big one, isn't it?
It's a big one. And what happens is that once they start to realise that and do that, they end up with the great clients, and great clients refer them to other great clients who refer them to other great clients. So they end up with a bunch of clients they love instead of bad clients who refer them to other bad clients who refer them to other bad clients, and they end up hating every day in their business because they're not.
And you'd have so much of your time eaten up by those people as well. Mm. Again, valuing your time, very
Absolutely.
Important.
Yep.
So in terms of the different types of business coaches, and if you're a small business and you're thinking about engaging with one, let's talk a bit about how to choose the right one, because it's not just there's quite a myriad of different types of business coaches that focus on different things for different types of businesses.
Absolutely, absolutely. And, I mean, you've got everything from the franchises like Action Coaches, who have very specific business programs, and you know exactly what you're getting up front, and they all do exactly the same thing. It doesn't matter which coach you get, you're following that same program.
Right.
So that's one form of business coaches. You've got business coaches who have a very financial background, and they're specifically going to be looking at the financial aspects of your business. You've got business coaches who specialise in startups or specialise in middle-sized businesses. There's often different specialties. And there's also coaches who specialise in particular industries as well. I actually started off in corporate, as you know, working in business and strategy in corporate for many years. So I've got a business strategy background, but then I also did life coaching training. So I'm actually a certified NLP practitioner. I'm a qualified extended disc trainer and profiler, and I'm productivity practitioner certified as well. So I've got a lot of mindset and behavioural knowledge as well that kind of comes into what I do in my business and combines in with that business experience. So that seems to be quite unusual in the business coach world, and really useful for my clients, because as we've talked about going through, a lot of the aspects that trip people up are actually around their own mindset and the way they are as an individual that can be impacting on the results in their business. So I find that quite helpful for my clients. So there's a, you know, I've got kind of a combination of different types of coaching fields kind of smooshed in together.
Right. And it's a very important point to make, is that there are different coaches who focus on different areas of business and have their specialisms. But how would you say, I mean, I know that people have said, well, isn't a business coach like a mentor? What's the difference there?
There is a difference. I actually have both types of packages. I've got business coaching and business mentoring. The coaching tends to be much more intensive and specific. So often when you're being coached, there's a lot more education, follow-up and action tasks. It's very condensed into specific areas. Mentoring is a lot more, I guess it's a gentler version. So there's a lot more hand-holding going on. There's a lot more nurturing through the process, whereas coaching is very much equipping the person to go do that and come back and see where you're at now, and then we'll move on to the next piece.
Mm.
Mentoring, there's a lot more interaction in between. There's a much kind of less intensive process.
Mm-hmm.
And usually a lot more, for example, if I'm doing a mentoring program and someone needs to be doing networking, I'll often go with them. Whereas if I was doing a coaching package, I wouldn't be doing that.
You just say, go off to that networking event.
I would
and hear
prepare
some tips.
Them.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I wouldn't necessarily go with them.
Interesting. Mm. And so having looked at the different types of coaches and in a way mentors as well, what are some good questions to ask when you're going out there to engage with a business coach or business mentor?
Okay. Like any industry, we have, you know, a fair share of, let's just say, not so great.
Dodgy.
You could say that. I'm not going to say that. professionals in the realm. So you do need to be quite careful when you're choosing a business coach. One of the things that I think is really important is to check out their business. You know, how long have they been in business? How successful is their business? How are they running their own business? And if they're, you know, just them and they're not really doing the business thing now, have they run businesses in the past? What is their success rate and experience in actually doing what they're selling you the service of?
Yeah, do as I say, not what I do.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. So that's a really good thing to look at. Some people get really hung up on qualifications. You know, they should have some kind of qualifications in the business area, but I think it's also wise to not put all your eggs in that basket. I know quite a few people who have multiple certifications but have done very little actual coaching.
Mm.
So just looking at the qualifications can be a little bit of a cloud if you don't dig further.
Mm. And would you have expected them to have their own coach, or perhaps they have gone through that process?
Any good coach will have a coach or mentor of their own.
And it's okay to ask that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And let's face it, really, if they don't, then they obviously don't really believe in what they're doing themselves. You know, coaching's all about getting you in your peak performance in your industry and in your business. If we don't believe that that's necessary, it's kind of a, you know, a hypocrisy in a way. I have I actually have two really great mentors, and I have a business coach who I see.
Well, there you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's a good thing. Do as I say and do as I do as well as what I say.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And in terms of, is it okay to ask, as you would with any other contractor or a person helping you, can I have have you got any testimonials or existing clients or
absolutely.
Previous clients?
Yes,
to use as referrals?
Absolutely. I love doing that. There's nothing better than finding out that a prospective client knows someone else who you've worked with.
Yes.
And you can say, you know what, go ask such and such. You know, I didn't realise you knew them. I actually had one last week, an exec who called me, because I do corporate work as well, obviously.
Mm.
And she actually knew quite well two of the upper management in another company who I've been working with for 9 months. So I just said to her, give them a call.
Yeah.
Have a chat to them.
Yeah, especially if you know
someone
already.
And then they'll give you an objective opinion, you know, about what I do. And then you can feel free to call me back and ask me more questions.
Yeah.
Most coaches worth their salt will ask for a half an hour conversation or face-to-face before they'll agree to take on a client because it needs to be a fit. So it's not just you need to be a fit for the coach. It's also they need to be a fit for you.
So they may reject you.
They may.
They may not take you on as a client.
That's right. Exactly. I don't take on every client, and I tell them that straight up front. Often there'll be, like, for example, health and wellness clients. And not that I don't love health and wellness, but I have another coach who specialises in that type of business, and she knows health and wellness inside out and backwards. So if someone comes to me in a health and wellness business looking for a coach, I'll have a chat to them to work out what their needs are, but 9 times out of 10 I'll refer them to her.
Okay. Interesting. So basically, once you've when's the best time to really? We talked about the best time to really engage with a business coach is probably when you're starting. But I guess people don't have the funds generally when they're first starting up, unless they've hit themselves with a wonderful redundancy package.
Well,
that they can
I was going to say
with.
There's yeah. a lot of those. We've actually had a lot of that at the moment. There seems to be a lot of retrenchments going on in middle management. So we've actually had a few people come in lately who are looking to start up, but. Basically, if you're hitting that point where you feel like you're getting close to burnout, you just feel like you're slogging.
Or instead. Cash flow issues.
Well, and you're not loving what you're doing anymore is usually the first sign. Mm. Exhaustion and stress are the second signs. Or if you just feel like you've hit a plateau in your business growth and you're really not sure what else you can do, you've kind of tried everything already, that's a really good time to have a conversation.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think that yeah, I like the idea that once you're starting to lose focus, you're not really finding the passion anymore and why it is that you started out in the first place, you know, sit there and look at yourself and say, well, it is there somewhere.
People don't get to, you know, year 11 in high school and go, oh, I might start a small business and work 16 hours a day and make less than I would at Woolworths.
For the first 2 years.
Exactly.
So when you first engage with a business coach, what mental or psychological, you know, how should you be mentally prepared?
You don't. Just come, be yourself, have a conversation.
But be open.
Absolutely.
Be ready for change.
Don't hide anything. Be honest, because you're not going to have great results if you're not honest about where your business is at. And the more honest you are, the better results you'll get.
Absolutely.
But don't be afraid that you're, you know, failing. A lot of people think they're failing if they come to a coach. What you will probably find out once you have that half an hour conversation is that you're probably pretty much the same as everyone else who's out there in the small business world too. You know, it's just because you're working for yourself by yourself, you don't always realize that everyone else is fighting those same battles.
And it'll bring you back on track, help you find your passion again, help you get all those strategies and things under control so that you can get back to doing what you love and what we originally started with.
Yeah, and love doing what you love.
Yes.
Absolutely. And have a long-term, sustainable, profitable business.
Yes, long-term goals. That's great.
So, Alexi, homework time.
Homework time. Look, we're going to go, I think next week we're going to, I think actually coming off the back of today's show, it'd probably be a good idea to maybe think about whether or not you need to have a business coach or what sort of business coach you might want to engage with. You can, of course, check out Cheryl at beultimate.com.au. And there's a number of other websites as well that you can check out and come to us, ask any questions on the Facebook page as well for the Breakfast Boys.
Well, thank you very much, Cheryl. It's been a pleasure to have you on the show. This is Cheryl. She's our business coach as well as director of Be Ultimate. Once again, where can we find you?
But beultimate.com.au, and if you're a Twitter fan, I'm very active on Twitter as well. It's at Ultimate Shezza.
Fantastic. Well, stay away from the Jennifer Lawrence scandal, I guess you could say, for the time being on Twitter. Well, thank you very much, and thank you, Alexi, again. You can find her on her Facebook page, Boyd Office Management Services. Just type that after facebook.com, after the forward or backslash, which is it?
I always get confused.
Oh,
I don't know if it's
forward slash.
I think it's a backslash, isn't it? Forward slash, backslash.
It's forward slash. The backslash. Oh, we never know. The Breakfast Boys will come into you in a tiny bit of a song. This is Thirsty Merc in the Summertime, run by Callum. My name is Jake. With me is Callum and Nick. The Breakfast Boys. Talk to you.